No footer here now, though. As the Rugby World Cup begins tomorrow, there's sporting drama and a story about fatherhood, rugby and what it means to be a hero from the award-winning writer Gary Owen. Stupid Men, starring Matthew Gravel and Eve Miles.
Lots of times you wonder why you bother. When it's freezing, no one's turned up to watch. When you've been stamped on, smashed about, dragged down. You're so far behind the game is long gone, but still an hour left to play. When you've got a train on a Tuesday night after a day's work. Train Thursday night after a day's work, and then sit on a bus 2 hours Sunday to play. Get back midnight, be up at five for work when you're stiff and sore and creaking. But still, even in the worst match, even the ones you're really hating. The ball flicks back to me. I'm just outside their 22 and I'm looking at two defenders, one to my right, one to my left, and a gap maybe 10 foot between them. Guy on my left is this lanky, lively looking back, maybe 19 years old, fast on his feet. On my right is a prop, heavy, slow, blowing hard, sweat dripping off him. So I don't go for the gap. I run right to the prop, because he can stop me if he can get to me, but I've got enough left in the tank. I can put on a burst of speed last second and slip right past, or I hope I have. And the lanky, lively back sees what I'm up to. So he sprints over to tackle me himself, and I spin round, because where that lanky back was, there is now a gap in the defenders half a mile wide. Any of my team can pile through it if I can get the pass away. So I lift the ball, pick out a target, and the lanky back bearing down on me sees I've sucked him in. He stops, turns on his heels, desperate now to see who I pass the ball to, except I didn't. I suck it in twice, the ball is still in my hand, no one between me and the try line, and I run, and I dive. And that's a moment. That's a moment. And after, when we're all shaking hands, I find this lanky back. I say to him, good game, mate. I won't get you like that next year. And he says, no. No, you won't. Because next year I'm signing with the Ospreys.
Oh, that's him then. Off he goes to the Ospreys.
And you hate having your hair washed, don't you? But I just do it because I'm a mean mummy. Have you got the thing?
Which thing?
The thing that looks like a beak I said 5 minutes ago. Can you find it? That keeps the water out of our eyes?
Well, that thing right next to you.
Yeah. There we go. There we go, look.
So, just a development contract, but, yeah, you know.
And course I know. I know, because 10 years ago, Ryan James was the star of the Wales under-20 squad, in line to get signed by one of the regions and turn professional. His dream, since he was a tiny boy. But he got injured, was out 6 months. And the next year, there was another crop of brilliant young players and Rye was old news. And Ryan's a pretty straightforward bloke. What you see is only a little bit less than what you get. But everyone's got their stuff, and this is Ryan's. That he nearly got to live his childhood dream. And then he didn't. But the thing is, right now I'm worried about Ellie's cough. And the clanking noise the washing machine started making. And the water bill came today, and it was loads more than I thought, and I'm hungry, and of course I'm tired. And actually Ellie's cough is... I think it's a wheeze. And I would love to have the energy to worry about Ryan's crushed dreams, but I'm sure wheezing is one of those red flags that means your baby's going to stop breathing in the middle of the night.
It's probably nothing.
It's always probably nothing until it isn't.
Well, I'm going to call NHS Direct if you worry.
You'll be all right here.
Will there not be?
And I leave him with Ellie, go through to the front room, make a point of going to the landline because we get free evening calls and there's a noise on the street. And because I'm stupid, because it doesn't occur to me to be afraid of strange noises, I pull back the curtain and I look out. And there's three blokes. A next door's car with the windscreen smashed in, and these three blokes turn and they look at me. They're on the pavement right outside our house, not even a metre away, and this kid screams at me.
What are you looking at? You've got 10 seconds to get back to bed or I'm going to smash this window in.
And I freeze, because I don't know what to do. because I can't go back to bed. I wasn't in bed. And he starts punching the front window of our house, and it's going to smash. All that glass is going to smash into daggers, and then there'll be nothing between me and him, and I sort of yelp.
Right?
Take it, Ellie.
The thing is, though Ryan never went professional, he still plays.
We got a problem, boys.
A lot. So much they pay him a bit, not enough to live on, but so every week that's two nights training, two nights on the weights, plus the actual game, so he's a big bloke. And when they see him, these kids, they run.
You okay?
Yeah, fine. I might have wet myself a little bit.
That's all right, so do they. Right, we're calling the police.
Yeah, and they might turn up tomorrow. Come here, will you?
Hey. It's just kids being idiots. There's nothing to worry about.
No, I know.
Could run you to your mum's for the night if you want.
Well, I'm going to let some idiots chase me out of my own home. No way.
You're a tough little thing, aren't you? Hey. And look at that.
She's asleep.
She's the randomest baby.
We get through to NHS Direct in the end, and they say it's probably nothing. Might be best to go to the doctors first thing in the morning. So in Splott, how you get to see the doctor is, you don't phone or anything like that. You have to go before the surgery opens and wait on the street. I get there, 7:40. There's already two women waiting ahead of me.
Ooh, Mr. Sheep smells a bit pokey, doesn't he?
My phone said the weather in Cardiff this morning is -2.
Keep a blanket on.
And we've not been waiting 5 minutes and Ellie starts coughing. Not just a cough. That coughing you do when you've got a bad chest and you go out in the cold and it's like a knife in your lungs. What am I doing? What am I doing? What the hell am I doing bringing an 18-month-old with a bad chest to sit on the street when it's freezing? I must be mad. And then Ellie's coughed all she can cough and she does the only thing she can do.
Oh, Ellie, wait, mommy, get it.
She pukes. She pukes massive big streams of sick and chunks of curdled milk. Total strip-down job. And we're on the street in -2. And so, I do the only thing I can do. I go home. And so Ellie has to go another day without seeing the doctor. And Tuesday, our little branch surgery is closed. You get ill on Tuesdays, you go across town, to the main surgery. And you phone and they give you an appointment. And yeah, you usually have to wait, but in a waiting room in the warm. And as we're waiting, there's a sign I can't stop staring at. It says, if you have a child under 5 who needs to see a doctor urgently, please phone us as soon as the clinic opens and you will be given an appointment that day. And I can't stop thinking, why is it like that there? But at our surgery, you've got to wait on the street.
Because it's posh. We're Splott, we stand on the street. They're Penelan, they get to wait in the warm.
Not everybody can wait on the street. Little kids can't, sick people can't, old people can't, so they just give up.
Well, see, if they made it too easy to see the doctor, everybody be in there.
Yeah, but it shouldn't be like that.
I'm not arguing with you. What?
Well, do you think about what it'll be like when Ellie's older?
Yeah, all the time.
But do you think what it'll be like living round here?
What do you mean?
When she's old enough to go out on her own and her being safe.
Right, this is about those kids banging on the window.
No, not just them.
They wouldn't have done nothing.
Well, they were doing something. They were trying to smash our window in.
Look, it was just a one-off.
Hey, and there was that bloke who got chased around the streets and they beat the crap out of him.
Oh, that was his family spat, though.
So what, we're not going to let Ellie out? Well, she's just going to stay in the house her whole life?
What am I even supposed to say to that? I've got to be up in 4 hours, so if you're finished.
Yeah, I've got work tomorrow too.
Did I say you didn't?
Once we never went to bed on an argument. Once we neither of us would have been able to sleep if we'd been fighting and hadn't sorted it out. But that was before. Before we knew what it was like to be properly tired.
I'm part-time as a teaching assistant at the local primary. I walk down our street, round the corner, and there's police. Police in the schoolyard. Because twice this week, parents have been fighting with each other at drop-off. Because someone shagged someone's ex-boyfriend and God knows what, so... Now we've got little four-year-olds bursting into tears when their parents get handed over to the police at the school gate.
And this is where Ellie's going to school?
You said it was a good school, and if it's just a one-off...
Oh, my God, did you just say one-off? Again, I swear, I'm just going to completely lose it, though. I swear I will.
Right, so I won't say that, then. You did say it was a good school, though. Like, they're all really dedicated. You go on about that all the time.
They're dedicated because they have to be to cope with it.
But it got, like, a good rating from the inspectors.
Do you know what it got? It got effective.
Yeah, sounds good to me.
Effective means they're good at taking the kids they get and doing the best they can. It means taking kids still in nappies at four and can't hold a knife and fork and teaching them that biting till blood comes out is not acceptable in normal society. And the kids like Ellie, who are basically okay, they get left to play in the corner because they're basically okay. So they get ignored while the teachers try to fix the really screwed up kids. And is that all right, do you think?
All right, in what way?
For our little girl.
Essa's parents, she'll probably be one of the really screwed up kids.
Right. We are not putting up with this for Ellie. We are not staying here.
That's decided, is it?
You go to Rose Park, Penelan. They get signs of the doctor saying, if your child is sick, ring us and we'll fit them in.
Oh, right, well, that's what we'll do. We'll just move to Penelan.
No, it doesn't have to be there, just somewhere better than here. Unless you think second best is okay for your daughter.
Oh, okay, fine. That's sorted, Ellen.
Where are you going?
With your laptop.
Under the telly.
Right. So, we're going to move. Let's check out the options. Where did you say? Penelan, Rose Park. Let's see what we got. Right, £2.5 million buys you a beautiful three-storey townhouse. And what's the cheapest?
There, look. 180.
£180,000 for a two-bedroom flat. No garden and in need of renovation. But no, I love a project, so that's fine. It's just I'm bringing in £18,000 from work, another £5,000 from rugby, and you what?
About £4,000 for 2 days.
That's £27,000. And these days, they're careful. They only lend you, what, three times what you earn? So what's that then?
Ryan.
It's 108. So we could borrow 108, and the smallest place we could live in is 180. You see?
Do I see?
We can't afford
it. And that's it?
I'm already working two jobs.
Rugby's not a job, love.
They pay me to play. I do a tax return, says I'm a semi-professional athlete. How's it not a job?
So what are we going to do then? We just let her down, and you don't mind that?
We love her. And that's what matters. We never had money growing up and we never even noticed.
Yeah, we love her, but look what we make her put up with. Rubbish schools and crap doctors.
Well, we're crap parents because we're not rich.
I'm not saying that. Oh, listen to me, this stuff matters.
No, actually, you're not saying we're crap parents, are you? You're saying I'm a crap dad.
Oh, no,
because I can't magically earn more money.
No, I know you can't and I don't expect you to. But I could.
How's this?
What you do, what I do. There's no way we move on, postman. There's no way you get promoted or... And it's the same with teaching assistant.
You're going to ask me to sell my body.
Well, mine's a wreck, so...
Well, mine's not far up.
But what I could do is I could go to college.
Mm-hmm.
See, I could do a teaching degree part-time and I got the experience already.
And how much does that cost?
Well, you don't pay it back until you're earning. But that's the thing, after 5 years, I can...
5 years?
Yeah, it's a part-time, so yes. But after, I can go for teaching jobs. And the thing is, schools like ours, they really struggle to hold on to staff. But if you stay... You see, there's a girl at Willows. She's 26, she's head of two departments, she's on shed loads.
That sounds great.
And I can keep working part-time while I'm studying. They said that'll help, actually, because obviously it's relevant experience.
Well, that's brilliant.
It will mean a couple of changes.
OK.
I'm going to need time at nights to study.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Like most nights of the week. And, well, you're training half the week, aren't you? And then playing Saturdays and sometimes you're gone most of the day. And I'm going to need some time then too.
You're saying I've got to give up playing?
Not give it up, no.
But that earns us money. You're saying we need more money. Playing rugby earns us money.
For how much longer, Ray?
I got a few more years.
Yeah, and then? I'm not saying stop. I'm saying there's teams that just play on Saturdays for fun. Join one of them. You know, you've got to have some time off. But that's what it is. It's something you do for fun.
So that's the plan. You go to college, study, and in 5 years' time, you might get a job. And a few years after that, you might get a better one. And then we might be able to afford to move somewhere decent. In the meantime, I give up playing rugby.
It's not give up.
So we're actually poor, and by the time we can move, Ellie will be halfway done with primary school anyway.
You got a better plan? I'm dying to hear it. Come on, dying to hear it. And I can see what's happening. This is Ryan, now realising he has to give up the part of his life where he's still the big man, still the hero of the team. He's realising that all he gets to be now is a dad, and he's trying to think of ways to weasel out of it. He's trying to think of something to say that means he doesn't have to face this. He's going to say he should keep playing just for a few more years while he's still got the speed and the strength. And when he says that, I think I'm going to hate him.
So, do you think that everybody that lives in Splott, they're all letting their kids down?
What?
Because you never mention it. Like when you're chatting to next door, say, I never hear you asking them when they're moving out, but that must be what you think, that everybody who lives here, everybody who lives anywhere a bit rough, they're all letting down their kids.
No, not at all. I just think you've got to work to do the best for them.
We do work. We've always worked. Everyone we know works.
Yeah, but these days you've got to do a bit more than that. So will you do this?
And that's it. That's the plan. Kerry's going to go to college, and while she studies, instead of training or pounding the pavement or doing weights, I'll be looking after the baby.
Look, I have to get a place in college first.
You're bound.
Well, you don't know that.
Yeah, I do. I do know that. Because anything Kerry puts her mind to, she gets. And she puts her mind to this. She deactivates her Facebook. When she's looking at her phone at some article about child development, she doesn't stop. And then the day comes. Her interview.
I look all right.
You look amazing. Oh, hang on, there's a bit of sick on your shoulder.
Oh, God, no!
I'm joking. You're fine.
You could just wish me luck.
You don't need it.
And then it's weeks. And of course, the weeks feel like months. And then one Tuesday, I get a text. A girl I met is going for the same course. She's had an offer of a place. Have I heard anything?
Warren Gatland call up more players from the regions to bolster the national squad.
Was there any post this morning?
No, don't think so.
Because I think the offers have gone out.
Well, maybe it'll come tomorrow. Anyway, a best shift, or I'll be late for training.
We got nothing at all day? No flyers, nothing?
No, we didn't. Ah, oh, bloody hell.
And that gives it away, because we always get something. Just takeaway menus, but little Miss Ellie's latest thing is tidy up everything that comes through the letterbox into the bin.
You found anything?
I don't know, I can't see. I'll just take it all out.
But what's that there? That's it, that's your offer.
Looks like.
Go on then. Well?
I didn't get it.
What?
I didn't get a place, they don't want me.
Now, let me see. Well, no, hang on. It says you can apply again next year.
And?
Another year, you'll be a bit more ready for it.
It's a whole other year. You said yourself Ellie'd be halfway through school before we can afford to move, and now it's another year on top of that.
Well, it's not my fault, is it?
Oh, my God, did they say anything about you at all?
So, there we are, then. We wait another year.
And that's all you've got to say?
I could say anything I like is still going to be wrong.
Where are you off?
What do you think?
Were you going training now?
It was Tuesday night.
Oh, my...
Yeah, of course it is. Yeah, fine, you carry on. Why not?
Well, what else are we going to do?
Well, I tell you why not, because the girls are going out to celebrate getting their places, and I'm off too.
You're going out on the piss when I go training?
Yeah, not to celebrate, obviously, because I've got nothing to celebrate. But yeah, for the first time in 2 bloody years, I'm going out and you're staying home with a baby.
And so out she goes. I can see where Kerry is, because one of the girls she's with is tagging her on Facebook. They're making a night of it, finishing up in Retros, the bar where the 90s never died. The girls she's with are a good few years younger. And next to them, Kerry looks... well, she looks drunk. And she looks tired. It's all right, it's all right, Daddy's here. You're all right. All right. And my dad... quiet bloke, scaffolder he was. Spent the whole day hulking round planks of wood and iron poles. Rain sucking the strength out of you in winter, sun soaking you with sweat in summer. Then the drive back to the yard, and then he'd walk 3 mile home from the yard every night. Never home before I'd gone to bed, so I wouldn't see him nights. And I remember I used to love playing with Lego, and one time I got obsessed with making a helicopter out of Lego. We had instructions, but I couldn't do it. I was 5 or 6 now, and I'd say to Mum, "Mum, will you get Daddy to make me a helicopter when he gets home?" And Mum would say, "Yeah, if he's not too tired." And every single morning, I would wake up, and there'd be that little Lego helicopter next to my bed, just appear there, like magic. I'd get up, grab it, and go running for him. He'd already be gone. And I think now how exhausted he must have been every night. The aching weight in his arms, in his legs, in his head. To get home 9:10, filthy and sore. Have a wash, something to eat. And then all you'd want to do is nothing. Get your head down, get some sleep. But no, you know you can't do that. Because there's something else. You got to do this one more thing. You got to sit up in the dark of the night. Build this helicopter you've made 100 times before, only for it to get pulled to bits the next day in less time than it took you to make it. But you do it. You do it every night, every single night, without fail. And that's what I remember. When it's months since I've had a decent night's sleep and I'm up at 5 for work and somehow it's midnight already and there's dirty dishes in the sink or bins spilling crap everywhere and I could just ignore it, go to bed. I remember, and I think, just do it. Just push yourself a little harder. Because that's all I've ever wanted. To be a good dad. As long as I'm that, then I'm everything I need to be. Like my dad was to me. But now it turns out I'm letting Ellie down. And I'm letting her down, not because I don't love her. Not because I'm not kind or patient. Because I don't earn enough. Because I'm not rich enough. And I'd never had any idea that was what it took. If I'd have known, I'd have done something, figured out how to be rich. But no one ever said being rich was all that mattered. I'm sitting there with this little girl, snuggling, snoring softly in the curve of my neck. This little girl who loves me. Because she doesn't understand yet how I'm letting her down.
Hi.
It's all right, she's down.
We got any squash?
Squash?
Like orange. I just think I need to drink a lot of water, but I can't face
night,
it.
Was it.
It was brilliant, thank you. I really needed it. Thank you for letting me go.
Well, I don't remember having much of a choice.
Thank you, though. What?
You stink.
Well, I've been drinking.
All right. Sorry.
Try waking up next to you mornings.
Okay. Look.
I've been thinking, yeah, about all this stuff, the schools and the doctors and all that.
Yeah, right.
And if you think about it, like, we moved loads when I was little, and I just went to the school, wherever we were, I just went to the school up the road.
Right.
So it's like, it didn't used to be like it is now. You just sent your kid to the nearest school and it was fine, as we did. So everyone did, but now...
now it's not like that.
And everyone's panicking about good schools and crap schools, and they all used to be good schools, or good enough, and that changed. Now you've got to live somewhere posh or you're screwed, and that's mad. I mean, it's not like we expect things handed to us. I work. You work. It should be we get a decent school, decent doctors, be safe on the streets, you know, wherever we live. And who changed it?
Who, right?
Some stupid men in London. They got it wrong, not us.
Not you mean?
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. I'm doing everything I can, and it's still not good enough because of
all... And that's your answer?
It's how it is.
Because what are we actually going to do, right? What are we actually going to do to see that Ellie gets to a good school?
Well, you're going to...
Because what
college.
You just explained to me is why none of it's your fault. Because that's what matters, isn't it?
Oh, well, that's not what I meant.
Yes, it bloody is. Yes, it is. And you're too thick to even know it.
Well, you married me.
Well, so it's my fault now, is it? I thought it was some stupid men in London.
You married me and you knew I was never going to be rich, so what did you expect?
No, you're right, I knew that.
I love my daughter.
Yeah, you do, but not so much that...
No, go on, what?
No, I don't know, I'm just... It's the vodka talking, I'm going to bed.
You tell me what you were going to say.
If you do the first shift, I'll take over about four tonight, all right?
No, you come back and you tell me... Bloody say!
How are you going to make me? You're right. I knew you were never going to be rich. But I suppose I always thought you'd make something of yourself.
I sit, chair in Ellie's room. I always thought I'd be there to put her to bed. Every night. And pick her up whenever she cries. And tonight in the dark... I realise. Maybe I won't be. You know straight off how much they need you. Because they can't do anything, they need you for everything. Oh. You don't realise. Not straight off.
Hey.
Is how much you need them.
Hey, you're all right. You're all right, sweetheart. Daddy's here. Daddy's here. I'm here.
And then... Hello?
Yeah, is this Ryan James? My name's Will.
So I spent the whole day sick as a dog. Literally. Because of what was it? 9 double vodkas I had the night before, but also because of fighting with Rye. And one of those fights where, honestly, I can't remember exactly what I said, but that sick feeling is telling me...
Mummy did that for you?
...that some of it was the kind of stuff that's hard to take back.
Is that you? Rye?
You all right?
Not really.
No. Fair play.
You look like crap, by the way.
Cheers for that.
Still hungover?
No, I'm just shivering and sweating and being sick for fun. Come home to gloat, did you?
No, not really. No, I just had Will Marshall on the phone.
That's nice.
You got no idea who he is, have you?
I ran it up on The Voice year before last.
Was a tack coach for Italy till 2 years ago.
Right, that Will Marshall.
And now he's in charge of the Celts. And he was ringing me because we know they've had loads of injuries against South Africa. The Wales team now, not the Celts.
I didn't, but...
No, well, they have. So they called up more players for the Wales squad and that's left the Celts short in their second row.
Right.
Yeah, so they need cover for the next two games, so he's ringing me.
To ask, can you think of anybody?
No.
Oh, my God.
He wants me to play for the Cardiff Celts.
That's amazing!
No, it's not.
What's amazing is that he says a couple of their second row were off to France next year, so they're going to need replacements, permanent replacements.
Are you kidding me now?
No, I'm really not. If I do well these two games, and it could be me.
And I don't even need to say, because she already knows.
Because I don't follow the rugby much beyond the Six Nations, but I know this. Rugby players earn proper money. Money that would get us across town. Money that would get us to good schools and doctors where you wait in the warm and safe streets.
Come here, you. Oh, wow.
And she hugs me. And as she comes in close, I can see her eyes lit up for once with something good. And as her arms close round me, I can't tell what that good thing is. Is she pleased for me? Proud of me? Or is it the money? And so there I am, Monday morning. I'm stood outside the changing room door, and this is stupid. I know half the boys in there, but still I can't open the door. And then I do. And I find myself staring at the man who every commentator, apart from Brian Moore, agrees is the best scrum half in the world. He's wearing nothing but his socks. And he's squeezing a spot on his inner thigh. And then a hand on my shoulder.
Ryan!
And I'm expecting it to be a bouncer, and I'm expecting him to bounce me out, but of course it's not a bouncer, it's Will, the coach.
Great to have you with us, miss. I'm sure you know Sam.
I don't, but I know he is.
All right.
Yeah, grand. Good to meet you.
And Sam is, of course, captain of the Celts, captain of Wales, captain of the last Lions tour to Australia. And now my new mate.
So, how was it?
It was surreal. Like, today was what they call Clarity Day, and we just go through the game plan for Saturday, but it's like, they've got a video of every mistake every Glasgow player has made this season. Like, everything we got to watch out for. It's so detailed. Oh, and then...
What's that?
It's one of those juicer things you're going on about. It's for you.
These are like 100 quid.
I know. But Sam was going on about his missus loving hers, and I said you were after one, so he picks up his phone, tweets he fancies one for his mate, and that's it. That's all it takes. Somebody bikes it over, like, for free.
So it was good, then?
Yeah, it was, yeah. It was just, it was just surreal.
Yeah, you said.
But I just sort of feel like maybe I was a bit overwhelmed with it all. Like, once we got on the pitch,
You didn't really...
Like, I didn't know where to put myself a bit.
Oh, right. I mean, you haven't got many days to the match.
No, I know, I know. What?
This is a real chance, you know. Make sure you take it.
I open my eyes. Lovely warm day. Prickle of sun on my face. Lovely. And I can hear Kerry and Ellie downstairs. But no screaming or crying. Just playing. They've got up, let me have a lie in. And I smile. Thinking of them thinking to be nice to me. And then I remember, this is the day. And I'm chucking up every 10 minutes and I can't keep a thing down. I've seen boys being like this before. Di Richards in the under-16s. I remember he'd be puking for days before a match, but it's never been me. Oh.
Ryan, you all right?
Yeah, yeah. Just inspecting the plumbing.
Don't worry, the nerves get to us all. So, like I say, Glasgow, they're a good team, but they've lost a few boys to their national squad, so we've got a decent chance for a result.
Yeah, no problem, boss. Can't wait to get stuck in.
Yeah, so I'm thinking first 60 minutes, we'll put them away, and then last quarter of the match, I'll be looking to bring you on.
Yeah, can't wait.
Just see if you can keep some fluids down, yeah? We don't want you fainting before you get your hands to the ball.
So the first half comes and goes and it's tight. We go in at 40 minutes, 2 points behind, but still, the game's all to play for. And then second half, it's a messy game, scrappy, bad-tempered. We trade penalties back and forth, 1 minute we're in the lead, then 2 minutes later they are, and we get to 70 minutes. 10 minutes left on the clock.
So shall I start warming up, yeah?
Yeah, you go ahead, right?
And I can see the boys on the pitch are tired, sweat dripping off them, but their boys are tired too. Anything will win us the game. Try, penalty, sneaky drop goal. This is when he should send me on. I could run down that field with half the opposition hanging off me, I swear to God, and then Will turns. He comes up, he puts his arm round my shoulder, he says,
"Look, right, it's so tight, I don't want to mess up the combinations, so I'm going to leave you on the bench for this one, OK? Sorry, mate."
And that's it. 76 minutes. 77. 78. 79. And we lose. And I didn't even get a chance.
You should go for a run or something. Or get hammered.
I can't get hammered, can I?
You're never going to sleep.
Then I'll sit up with Ellie. You sleep.
Really?
Yeah, go on.
Oh, God, thank you so much.
Night. And I am more tense than I've ever been in my life. Every muscle in my body buzzing, dying to run and chase and push and shove and this tiny little sniffling thing in my arms. And I've got to wait for a week. And the week goes in a heartbeat. Half time, we're 8 points behind, and it's only a few lucky escapes have kept us as close as that. In second half, things don't get better. We scrape a penalty, but that's it. 20 minutes to go, and we're 14 points behind.
Boss? Boss?
Ryan, it's Will or Mr. Marshall.
Yeah, okay. You said I'd get a run out.
Yeah, once the game was in the bag.
Look, I get you trusting the boys, you know, but the fact is, they've let you down. I won't. You just gotta give me the chance.
And he frowns at me. And I think that I might have blown it.
Yeah, all right, get yourself warmed up.
Brilliant.
But Ryan, listen. Our second row boys, they both signed new contracts with us this morning. We won't have a place for you next season, so you go out, enjoy the game, but don't kill yourself out there, okay? Don't do anything stupid. There's nothing to play for but the game.
I jog up and down the side of the pitch. And there, right at the front of the terraces, is Kerry.
They're letting you on then?
Yeah, looks like it.
Well, good. There's not long left. Somebody needs to win this match, so get cracking.
Plastic pint glass in her hand, just like she used to. And smiling at me. Like she used to.
Coach just told me the players they thought were off to France. They're not going. They signed new contracts this morning.
You're kidding?
No.
And we look at each other. And it's not like the crowd and the noise and the game disappear, because of course they don't. It's all still there. It's just, none of it means anything.
So what do I do?
And it's gone. Our chance for a new life, and it now, it's gone. I feel like an idiot for thinking it was ever there at all.
Kerry.
And he's looking at me.
Kerry.
You go out there and you make me proud.
And out there, it's like the game I've been playing all my life, but everyone's faster, stronger, harder. My first touch of the ball. The defender comes in and I see the rest of the team look to where the ball is going next, taking for granted this little kid is going to take me out. They haven't got a clue. I get a hand to him, shove him out the way, burst through the line, and it's only 3 yards I make, but it's 3 yards they weren't expecting, and they are in a mess now. A couple of them slam into me, but too late. I get the ball away, a wild pass over their heads, and it finds our winger, and he just blurs, moves faster than I've ever seen anyone move in my life, and he's over the line. A try just left of the post, and the conversion is easy, and that's us, 7 points behind. 7 points to draw, 8 to win in 9 minutes. The other side bring on a load of subs, fresh legs, fresh arms, and the whole lot of them step it up a gear. And I am getting hit and hit and hit, and we're getting beaten back down the field, but then a penalty just inside our half of the field. And the fullback whacks it over the posts. 2 minutes left, and we're 4 points behind. A penalty won't do it, a drop goal won't do it. It's got to be a try. We kick off, but now it's like the wind's with us. The other side are panicking and making silly mistakes. The clock is ticking down, but we are pushing closer and closer to their try line. And the closer we get, the more they panic. And 80 minutes is up, and the next time the ball goes dead, the game does too. But every move we make is perfect now. And the ball flicks back to me. I'm just outside their 22, and I'm looking at two defenders, one to my right, one to my left. And a gap maybe 10 foot between them. And the thing is, both these blokes look like they could take me. And they both charge me. And I run straight between them, ball under my right arm, I hand one of them off with my left, and I just slip through the gap, and the try line is there ahead, and no one can stop me. And out the corner of my eye, their fullback streaking across the pitch gets to me just as I'm crossing the line, and I dive for the ground, and even as I'm in the air, he's wrapping his arms around me, trying to rip the ball out of my hands, and I stretch to keep the ball out of his reach, and we smash into the ground. And I bounce straight back up, because half the team is there pulling me to my feet. And I see Kelly. I see her doing this little victory dance, chucking a pint pot in the air.
Yes, yes, yes!
And then I look around, and there's the fullback pointing and pleading with the referee. And one of the touch judges trots up, and him and the ref talk, and the touch judges point in, and they look at each other. They nod. They've made a decision. And the ref jogs up.
Spill the ball forward. No try. No try.
And I look at Kerry. And her face says nothing. And she looks at me, her face saying nothing. And then she turns. And walks away. When I come down from the shower, Kerry's playing with Ellie in the lounge.
Here he is.
Is she all right?
Yeah, a bit of a punami earlier, but that tooth's finally through. Do you want to go to your dad? Yeah? Go on, you go to your dad.
Come here. And I take her.
Because your daddy won the game today.
I didn't.
Yes, he did. Your daddy won the game today, little girl. I know he did. I saw it with my own eyes. Just some stupid men got it wrong.
And the warm weight of Ellie against me. The little arms stretching around my neck. The tiny, heavy head finding its place in the curve above my collarbone. And I pull Kerry to me. And she comes. And the three of us together. Against everything. And that'll have to be enough.
In Stupid Men by Gary Owen, Ryan was played by Matthew Gravel, Kerry by Eve Miles, and Will by Rodri Mailer. It was a BBC Cymru Wales production, directed by Helen Perry.